Wave Sound presents an unabridged recording of Hitler's Resurrection by Steve Matthews, narrated by Deirdra Whelan. Part 1. New Beginnings. Chapter 1. Her screams echoed around the ruins of Berlin Zoo, a mixture of pain and anguish, accompanied by the drunken laughter of the queue of Russian soldiers impatient for their turn. They had stripped her and tied her spread-eagled to the carcass of a dead camel, a sight that so amused the conquering Russians that they took a photograph with a camera they found in an abandoned office in the zoo's administration block.
"One hump or two,"
one of them yelled as he dropped his pants and prepared to mount the woman.
"In your case, Ilya, it will be one hump and you are finished."
The Russian raised his machine gun and let loose several rounds into a nearby tree, scattering the monkeys that had survived the shelling that day.
"I'm not having those little bastards staring at my hairy ass when my turn comes. They will think you are a cousin, Yaroslav, and they might want to join in. Now that would be a photograph worth taking. You humping the whore and the monkey humping you."
Raucous laughter came from the rest of the men as Ilya had his way, then climbed off the woman, while Yaroslav prepared to take his turn. The rest of the men in the queue continued drinking, shouting encouragement, and yahooing as they waited. And so it went that night, after the Germans surrendered what remained of Berlin, and the Russians celebrated the only way they knew how. For the first time in what seemed like years, the city was still and almost ghostly quiet. The ground had stopped rumbling, and there was no more shelling, no tanks thundering through the streets, and no machine gun fire echoing through the shattered buildings. All that could be heard was the woman's moans and screams, which continued through the night, not stopping until the Russians stopped. Earlier that day, several members of the Red Army had been at the rear of the Chancellery building, in the gardens where Eva Braun had once gathered with other women to smoke and talk, when they discovered the exit doors for the Fuhrer bunker. Within an hour, the bunker had been ransacked. Then someone in authority stopped the looting when they realised the significance of the find. As they scoured the maze of rooms, they came across a woman crouched in the corner of what used to be Martin Bormann's office, clutching a Gestapo document.
"She's a German. Just shoot her and let's move on. They have vodka and they are celebrating at the zoo and I don't want to miss out," one of the Russians said.
"I am not German," the woman muttered, hoping they would understand. "The Gestapo said I am Polish. Polski."
And she waved the document at them, an anguished expression on her face.
"German, Polish, they're all the same to me. Sluts, every one of them. What are you doing down here, whore?"
"Hiding. The door was open. It's underground and I thought I would be safe from the shelling."
The two Russians chatted quietly to each other.
"We could shoot her now, or we could have some fun first, then shoot her later. What say you, comrade?"
"It has been a long time since I have had a woman."
It was an easy decision for the two soldiers, so they dragged the young woman out of the bunker and forced her into the back of their truck, then drove across the shattered city to what remained of Berlin, to the zoo at Tiergarten. The grounds were full of dead animals and Russians celebrating their victory. Several hard-faced female soldiers yelled obscenities as they pulled the screaming woman from the back of the truck and tied her to the camel's carcass. Elsewhere in Berlin, the night was still. It had been a long time since things had been this quiet. The Red Army had virtually surrounded the city, bringing the German army to its knees after a month of fierce fighting. In the first 6 days of the battle, they had fired 1,236 shells into Berlin, 100,000 tons of steel. Now they had stopped the bombardment, and the British and Americans were no longer bombing. The sounds of war appeared to have washed over the city in a tidal wave of explosions and fire, leaving it destitute and derelict. Some facades of the more resilient structures remained, flames still licking around the soot-encrusted shattered windows of this one, smoke coming from that one, all of them looking as if they might tumble into the street at any moment. Rubble, broken furniture, bricks and glass spilled from the footpaths, where abandoned trucks, trams and military vehicles slowly burned, sending ribbons of acrid smoke into the dark night sky. Bodies lay crumpled and broken, frozen in strange positions. Soldiers, civilians, the ghastly faces of dead horses. It was a scene from the apocalypse. During the preceding day, large numbers of German soldiers had crept out of their hidey holes, waving white flags, a mixture of battle-hardened SS and terrified teenagers who had fought alongside weary old-age pensioners from Josef Goebbels' Volkssturm, the People's Army. The Russians had attacked Berlin with 2,500,000 soldiers, 6,000 tanks, 7,000 aircraft, and 41,000 artillery pieces. The Germans scraped together 1 million soldiers and 800 tanks. It was a bloodbath, and soon they would be lining up the bodies in the street, row after row of them. The city reeked of death and decay as the surviving German military were herded together and stripped of their weapons, which now lay in huge, unguarded piles. Rifles, anti-tank guns, binoculars, helmets and daggers. SS officers were pulled aside for questioning. Many of them were dealt with on the spot and shot by the Russians. The remaining prisoners stood around in groups, watching the ebullient Red Army celebrate with their strange dancing, arms over each other's shoulders, crouching on their haunches, kicking their legs out to the clapping and singing of the Kamradjes. If anyone knew how to celebrate, it was the Red Army. It had been a long, hard, terrible war, and the night was made for celebration. But Stalin had issued a stern warning to Marshal Zhukov, the Russian commander responsible for conquering Berlin. Churchill and President Truman had grave misgivings about possible Russian retaliation against the German civilian population, and Stalin wanted to be seen to be dignified and statesmanlike. Zhukov was not interested in politics. "Comrade Stalin, my Red Army has suffered 360,000 dead and wounded from this battle alone. I am told that the conflict in total will have cost Russia 27 million lives, civilians and military." Zhukov was speaking on the telephone, lucky that Stalin could not see the anger in his eyes. "The suffering at all levels has been beyond our imaginings. The German hordes invaded our homeland in 1941, murdering, raping and pillaging across our great land, showing no regard for our civilian population and no respect to our history. And you want my men to be polite to them now?" "Your brave soldiers do not have to be polite, Comrade Zhukov, but they have to be seen to be polite." Stalin was being unusually patient with his commander. After all, the war was over and the victory had gone Russia's way. "I will issue the written order for no retaliation against civilians, and I will take the flak from Churchill and the Americans if there are one or two violations. Churchill and I get along famously. The man is a fine drinker, and I am thinking he must have a little Russian blood in him from somewhere in the past. He will understand that your men have to let off steam, and I will make arrangements to have any, what shall we call them, accidents, dealt with in a manner that will satisfy our allies." After taking their turn with the girl, some of the Russians lit a fire and found several dead Heck cattle in their bombed-out enclosure at the zoo. They cut up one of the animals and cooked the meat over open fires, eating voraciously.
"This is better than horse meat, Ilya." "Horse, dogs, rats, who cares? Meat is meat. However, vodka... now that is something different and must be taken seriously. You would not know the difference between good vodka and donkey piss, my friend. Ah, but I would if I saw you bottling it."
Within an hour, they were all well-fed and feeling mischievous, so they discharged their rifles in the air and tried to shoot some squirrels from nearby trees. Then it was back to the drinking, anything they could find in the ruins of the surrounding suburbs. The singing and dancing continued until they fell over, grinning like fools and cursing like gypsies. They slept where they fell, in the ruins of the once magnificent Berlin Zoo, thankful that they had survived the war, and dreaming of their wives and children. It would not be long before they returned to their homeland. When the young woman woke the next morning, bruised and bloody, a monkey was examining her face, its soft, leathery finger probing her ears. She realised one of her hands was free, and she managed to brush the inquisitive creature aside, though it was far from happy and took to shrieking as it scampered up a tree. Two young Cossacks wandered onto the scene on horseback, alerted by the sound of the screaming monkey. The Russian troops had left at dawn, and the Cossacks were part of a surveillance unit moving around the city, reporting any pockets of resistance and areas in need of an urgent clean-up. Disease was always going to be an issue with so many bodies trapped inside shattered buildings and lying on the streets. Every small piece of grass or backyard already appeared to have at least one white cross on it, so the remaining dead had to be gathered up and their corpses disposed of quickly. That included animals, and that was why the two Cossacks found themselves at the zoo. One of the men climbed down from his horse and examined the young woman, cutting the remaining ties from her limbs.
"She's alive, Alexei, but she's in a bad way. Looks like the slut got what she deserved. Anyway, we have more important things to concern ourselves with. How the hell are we going to get rid of all these dead animals? I mean, a grave for an elephant is one thing. You only need a hole, a big one, I'll grant you that. But a giraffe? It's a good job we don't have to make coffins."
The other Cossack continued to take in the woman.
"She looks quite young, Alexei, and she's muttering something I can't make out. Do you speak German? I think she is talking in German. What should I do?
You should go back to headquarters and ask for a bulldozer and a digger so we can get rid of all these carcasses.
The girl, Alexei, what should I do about her?
Do what you like. Have her if you wish, but don't be long about it, as we have work to do."
10 minutes later, the Cossack was trotting through the shattered streets of Berlin with the young woman's naked body draped over the front of his saddle. Bedraggled, dust-covered people were already starting to come out from their basements, staring with grey faces and terrified, sunken eyes. Standpipes had sprung up in many streets, and civilians queued quietly with saucepans and buckets at the ready, waiting their turn, looking quizzically at the Cossack and his passenger. Public order was vital in the early days after the battle for Berlin, and bureaucrats were already looking for somewhere to work, carrying battered filing cabinets and desks through the streets, trying to find a place to establish an office. There would be no rubber stamps or headed paper for a while. Scribbled notes and trust were all there was. Ration cards had yet to be printed. Getting enough basic food, water, and medical supplies was the priority. Every bank in the city had been looted, but some would be up and running again within a week. Local officials, working under Russian instructions, already had female road gangs clearing rubble from the roads and sidewalks. The great clean-up had begun. It would be a while before electricity and water were reconnected, but several bakers in the outer suburbs had been hard at work since the early hours, sending bread into the city to feed the homeless and destitute. Children hunted for lost toys and pets amongst the ruins. Old women pushed prams around, searching for firewood and scraps of food, as tens of thousands of displaced people gathered around pathetic little fires, staring at each other, waiting for some water to boil and a conversation to begin. As the streets were cleared, carts and wagons appeared, usually pulled by horses, occasionally by old men. Children sat atop the piles of furniture and belongings as old women walked alongside them, going to who knows where. The whole country was shattered and wasted. The Cossack rode slowly, his horse tossing its head on occasion, spooked by a building that unexpectedly tumbled into the street in front of him. The sound was like an earthquake, with choking dust, ash, and sparks filling the air as he made his way around the mess. He eventually arrived at the front of the Charité Universitätsmedizin Hospital at Berlin's Humboldt University. Much of the hospital and adjacent faculty had suffered bomb damage, but Red Army doctors and staff were already moving into the few buildings that remained intact, so they could attend to the expected influx of patients. Most of the hospital's administration sector had collapsed, but the wards seemed to have suffered less damage. People were rushing here and there, some in white coats, unloading trucks and carrying hospital equipment to the operating theatres and wards. As several aircraft flew low over the city, the roar from their engines echoed around the devastation, and people ducked and took cover instinctively. The horse reared up again, and the Cossack grabbed the woman's hair to stop her falling off.
"What have you there, comrade?"
a nurse asked. We found her at the zoo. Some of our troops helped themselves last night. She's in a bad way, and to tell you the truth, I'm not even sure that she is still alive.
Let me look. The nurse reached out and lifted one of the woman's eyelids before declaring, She is alive, and more is the pity. We have not established the rape ward yet, so God only knows where I can put her. The Cossack dismounted and pulled the woman from his horse, holding her sagging body in his arms.
Show me where you want her.
The nurse led the way, making conversation as she went.
It looks as if you and your colleagues had fun last night.
Not me. I have been on patrol from midnight, and my partner is still at the zoo, trying to work out what to do with the dead animals. It is a terrible mess. The whole city will stink of rotting elephants if we don't bury them soon.
Did you know there was a lion here at the hospital early this morning?
A lion?
Yes, it must have escaped from the zoo and somehow made its way here. One of the guards shot it, of course, and nobody was hurt. But we have no idea what it got up to on the journey over. I expect we will find out if someone is brought in mauled. She stopped outside a door to a makeshift ward. Put her on one of the beds in there for now. I will check on her later. The young woman was left alone for several hours, until at last the nurse reappeared. However, all she did was move her to another ward, where a handwritten sign was hung on the door handle. Rapes. It was not expected that rape victims would come forward so soon, and the ward was not properly established yet. Russian doctors were more interested in treating Red Army heroes than German sluts, but Stalin had decreed that a rape ward should be established in every hospital, so it was attended to with the minimum of fuss. Abortions would be performed and gonorrhea and other venereal diseases treated, though the hospital was short on antibiotics and still waiting for the gynecological instruments to arrive. There would soon be a flood of German women and young girls, some prepubescent, who were the victims of Red Army rapes. They would get no sympathy from Russian medical staff. A doctor joined the nurse at the woman's bedside. She woke for a while, but is unconscious again, the nurse said. I gave her water. She had this piece of paper in her hand, a Gestapo document by the look of it, but we need someone who can read German to translate for us.
I am told Red Cross translators will be available soon, the doctor said.
She is quite young and has been badly beaten, as you can see, doctor. She does not look good to me, and she keeps muttering something about her baby.
Was there a child with her?
Not that I know. She is a real mess. Delirious, too. The Russian doctor gave the patient a cursory look over, checking her pulse and listening to her heart.
Just a few cuts and bruises, a split lip, maybe a broken nose and a rib or two. She will recover in time.
I see that she is still bleeding vaginally. The nurse nodded and shrugged. The doctor said,
Clean her up as best you can, and I will be back later to see if she needs stitching up. Sometimes our boys can be unnecessarily rough, but they have had a hard war and deserve their fun.
An hour later, the nurse knocked on the doctor's office door and told him the woman had suffered a miscarriage. The doctor sighed.
So that accounts for the bleeding, eh? Well, there is little need for me to examine her now. If she has miscarried, then she will not be needing a termination. Stitch her up yourself if she needs it. The practice won't go astray. Leave her to rest a couple of days and I will get the Red Cross to find her some clothing. Then we can release her.
He opened a file, lit his pipe and put his feet up on his desk while a cloud of foul-smelling smoke gathered above his head.
Do we know her name?
The nurse looked at the notes on her clipboard. I found someone who could read German. According to the piece of paper she had with her, a Gestapo report, by the way, her name is Klara, Klara Filipek, a cook. 3 days later, Klara seemed to be improving. She could barely speak, as the cut lip the doctor had diagnosed turned out to be a fractured jaw, which was subsequently bandaged tightly, making it almost impossible for her to move her mouth. She was fed through a straw. Several days later, she managed to communicate with the Red Cross representative using sign language, scribbling on pieces of paper, and grunts.
I can get you some paperwork so you can move freely around the city, the Red Cross agent said. Do you know what you are going to do? Where you are eventually going to go?
Klara shrugged and muttered between clenched teeth.
Poland, I suppose. Why there? It is as bad as here. The place is in ruins. Towns and cities have been turned to rubble. People have no money, food or jobs, and no homes. Refugees are wandering around with nowhere to go, robbing each other during the night so they can feed themselves and their children. You are safer in Berlin than Warsaw. At least here, the Americans and British are trying to instill some sense order now they have arrived.
Sister. My sister. She will help, I am sure.
Do you have an address?
She lived in Krakow at the start of the war. That is all I know. I have a name, but no address.
We have a transport going to Warsaw, then on to Krakow at the end of the week. If the doctor says you are fit to travel, I can arrange a passport and visa for you, and you can hitch a ride in one of the trucks. They are taking medical supplies and clothing to our depots in Poland.
Klara closed her eyes and sighed, thanked the woman from the Red Cross, and said she would be on the truck whether the doctor permitted it or not.
True to the agent's word, the Red Cross delivered a passport and travel visa in the name of Klara Filipek, Polish citizen, along with some clothes that fitted reasonably well. The truck collected her a few days later, and she sat in the back among the boxes and crates, making herself as comfortable as she could with a few blankets she found in a large laundry bag. After a long, uncomfortable journey, she was eventually delivered to the Red Cross offices in Krakow before being transferred to hospital. They checked her jaw and the bleeding between her legs, which had started again several days into the journey. An American doctor with a much kinder manner looked after her this time, insisting she get at least 2 weeks' bed rest.
"The butcher who attended to you in Berlin should be struck off," the doctor said after he examined her. "You are a very lucky young woman. I am surprised you are still alive because you have lost a great deal of blood and are still bleeding down below, though I think we are on top of the problem now. What happened to you?"
"Soldiers. Russian soldiers," she muttered, with her eyes closed.
"Well, you will be looked after properly from now on, and there will definitely be no Russians involved, doctors or soldiers."
"Thank you," Klara said with a sigh.
"Look, I have to tell you this, and there is no easy way, so forgive me if I sound a little blunt. I can see that you have given birth in the past, but I'm afraid you will not be able to bear any more children. The internal damage cannot be repaired."
"I suspected as much," she replied, her eyes closed and her bottom lip quivering painfully as a tear slipped from the corner of her eye.
"At least you are alive."
"That is something I should be grateful for," she asked, turning away.
Chapter 2. Hermann Göring sighed as his Mercedes limousine came to an unexpected stop at the village of Bruckfusch in Bavaria. He leaned forward and tapped his driver on the shoulder.
"What the hell is going on, Hans? Why the delay?"
"I am not sure, Reichsmarschall, but it looks as if there is a roadblock ahead."
The driver stuck his head out of the side window and saw several soldiers making their way down the line of trucks towards the Mercedes.
"Someone is coming."
"Not the Russians, I hope,"
Göring said with a nervous chuckle.
"Americans, by the look of them," was the reply.
A face appeared at the rear side window and a set of gloved knuckles tapped politely, signalling to Göring to lower the glass. With an endearing smile, Hermann said,
"Oh dear, it looks as if this might be the end of the road for me."
"It is indeed, Reichsmarschall."
And the American officer opened the door, indicating to Göring that he should get out. They took him to an office in a building nearby, where he ceremoniously surrendered his pistol and dagger to General Robert Stack of the Texas 36th Division, while photographs were taken for posterity. It was all very dignified, and Göring was pleased with the respect the Americans showed him.
"May I ask, Reichsmarschall, where were you going?"
"Switzerland, my dear fellow."
"Why so many vehicles? We counted at least 20 in your motorcade."
"Ah, yes, my personal belongings, of course. A few necessities to see me through the coming months. In addition, I have a responsibility to keep my staff employed. My cooks, a valet or two, a maid and a cleaner, a gardener also. I am sure you understand, General. One has to maintain standards."
"Well, you are our prisoner now, and we have taken possession of your belongings and are holding your staff for questioning.
You will be relieved to know that in view of your rank and stature, you will not be sent to a prison camp. I understand we have access to the Palace Hotel in Luxembourg, and they have a room waiting for you there. You will be under house arrest and will be treated with due deference. Our people will have a few questions, I dare say, and it will be in your interests to cooperate. Or what? I will be tortured? We are not the Gestapo, Reichsmarschall. There will be psychologists and clinicians, all from the military, of course. I assure you, you will not be mistreated in any way. The Reichsmarschall nodded appreciatively and smiled to himself. Perhaps the Americans would want him to help with the rebuilding of Germany. It made sense, at least to Hermann Göring. The Palace Hotel in Mondorf-les-Bains, Luxembourg, was once a glamorous spa hotel for the rich and famous, but was now used as a processing point for senior Nazis captured after the war. An imposing four-story building, it had become what was effectively a posh prison camp, surrounded by electrified barbed wire fences and guard towers with spotlights. Inside, the luxury fixtures and fittings had mostly been removed, and the bedrooms on the third and fourth floors turned into cells. Each room now had a bed, a desk, and a chair. The Americans called the place Camp Ashcan. High-value prisoners such as Hermann Göring were allocated a psychologist who would accompany them on walks around the grounds, help with their daily routines as they settled in, and talk with them about some of the more interesting aspects of the war and their roles in it. Within a few days of his arrival, Göring found himself in the company of other Nazi notables, such as Joachim von Ribbentrop, Hitler's Minister for Foreign Affairs, and Generalfeldmarschall Wilhelm Keitel, and Generaloberst Alfred Jodl, both senior Wehrmacht officials. Grand Admiral Karl Dönitz, chief of the Kriegsmarine, and nominated as the Fuhrer's successor in his will, was also there. In addition, there were bankers and senior civil servants from a variety of organisations within the Nazi regime and the Reich government. At the end of the list, and coming as a great surprise to Hermann Göring, was another name that he was more than familiar with, his brother, Albert. It was hoped that by placing the high-ranking Nazis in a pleasant environment and treating them with respect, they would regain their health and vitality, relax, and start to talk openly about their roles in the war and Hitler's philosophies and decision-making processes. The psychologists were there to befriend them and report to the American High Command any valuable information they could obtain. John Gillen, an American intelligence officer, was assigned to Hermann Göring. He found the Reichsmarschall to be surprisingly amiable and pleasant company. There was no doubting Göring's intelligence or his desire to retain his dignity while in captivity. He had, after all, been second only to Hitler in the chain of command and appeared to be willing to help in exchange for certain privileges and freedoms while in the complex. He was the most senior of all the captured Nazis. Gillen noted in his reports that Göring was delusional. "You know, John, I understand why we are here, all of us, the Führer's ministers and military advisers. You can question us all you like, but you will never escape the reality that you won and we lost. Does it matter how or why? There will never be another war as big as this one, let me tell you, because there will only ever be one Adolf Hitler. How is that for an overview? A dose of reality for you psychologists?" "That's very good, Reichsmarschall. It is a start and tells me a lot about your state of mind and inner thoughts. You have already been cooperative, and for that, I thank you. Now that we have established a rapport, John, I have something of concern to discuss with you, which I hope you will take seriously." "If something concerns you, Reichsmarschall, of course I will take it seriously. I often overhear your men talking, the guards and so on, as they go about their daily duties when I am locked in my room. They are unnecessarily disrespectful. They call me Fetter Junger, you know."
"Fetter Junger?"
"Yes, it means fat boy. It is a terribly unkind and unnecessary insult. I am somewhat rotund and always have been, but there is little to be gained by treating someone like me, in the unfortunate position I now find myself in, with playground humour. They are bullying me, and I will not have it."
"I understand.
Would you not say that I have been more than obliging so far? Am I not giving you appropriate facts and figures, information that is helping you understand the inner workings of Hitler's cabinet and the German war machine?
I would say that you have been forthcoming, yes. I agree with that, and I welcome it.
Then please, John, no more of this fat boy, or I might just be heading for a bout of amnesia.
Gillen wanted to appear sympathetic, but he also had to take into account the reality of Göring's position.
I understand completely, Reichsmarschall. However, you must face the fact that the war is over, and you Nazis have a lot to answer for. Many people have died, and a whole continent has to be rebuilt before it can start over. Things are being uncovered, atrocities the like of which have not only previously been unheard of, but are also unthinkable. People no longer have respect for you or your rank, I'm afraid.
Ah, my dear John.
Göring's smile disappeared.
We Germans may have lost this little stoush, but we will be Nazis forever, make no mistake about that. In 100 years' time, people will still talk of Hitler as the Fuhrer, and I will always be known as Reichsmarschall Göring, second in command of the whole Reich. I should tell you that I spoke against war from the outset. Our people did not seek conflict, but our leader roused them to the cause. I mean, why should some poor slob of a farmer want to risk his life when the best he could get out of a war would be to return to his farm in one piece? Neither British, nor American, nor the Russian people wanted to go to war either. But their leaders are the ones who make decisions. Whether those leaders are democratically appointed or have taken control of their countries matters not. It is always a simple issue to drag the masses into the fray. All you need to do is tell them they are about to be attacked by an enemy. And those that still resist, you denounce for their lack of patriotism and for exposing their country to danger. That is how it is done.
He shook his head knowingly.
It is not difficult.
Göring enjoyed walking in the beautiful gardens with Gillen. They talked of the war and Hitler a great deal.
The Treaty of Versailles was the start of it all, you see. If it had not been so draconian, Hitler would not have been seen as the saviour of the country. Germany was drowning because the Allies left it oppressed after World War I. Our people were humiliated and our economy crippled. Let us hope that when this war is concluded, the Allies do not make the same mistake. Because if they do, they will be leaving a platform for a Fourth Reich to build upon. But Germany needs a leader, and yours is dead. Hitler died in his bunker on the 30th of April.
Göring suddenly stopped mid-stride and turned to smile at the American.
Believe that if you will, John. But there are those of us who know different.
Klara was kept in the Krakow hospital for several more weeks. Her recuperation was slow, and she needed to regain her strength before setting out to find her family. In the meantime, a Red Cross representative arrived to interview her to see if they could help. They had a huge number of misplaced persons and refugees on their books. Maybe one of them was Clara's sister. Klara showed the agent the crumpled Gestapo memo.
Where did you get this?
A lie was called for.
I was a canteen cook at the Reich Chancellery, and I took shelter in an abandoned bunker, which the Russians said was the Fuhrer bunker. I was hiding in an office and came upon it. It seems I was being investigated by the Gestapo for some reason. Perhaps they thought I was a Jew or a spy.
Klara felt her face flush. She was not a good liar, but it was safer than telling people she had been Hitler's cook, and until recently had been carrying Martin Bormann's child.
All I know is that my sister's name is Natalka, and our family name is Filipek.
It was not much to go on, but it was a start, and the Red Cross agreed to help her find Natalka. Krakow, unlike many Polish cities, had not been devastated by the war. It was one of the few great cities that was largely intact, which meant that it was not difficult to locate an address. Finding the people that lived there before the war, now that was a very different proposition. Krakow was full of displaced people from around Poland, gravitating towards the city, seeking work, security, and the possibility of putting a roof over their heads. It would be no mean task to find someone called Natalka Filipek in such a large city.
But the representative from the Red Cross took detailed notes when she interviewed Klara, and the next day, inquiries began. Ralph Fuchs' SS uniform had been hanging in the polished cedar wardrobe, stain-free and neatly pressed, for several weeks. He could not bring himself to destroy it, and he knew the risk he was taking by not doing so. But he was expecting word to come through at any time about his escape to South America. He would wear it again soon enough, when he was back among other like minds. In the meantime, he was not unduly concerned about the possibility of being questioned by the authorities if stopped while he was out on the streets. He could speak Polish like a local, with no trace of a German accent, which had helped him when he was hunting Jews in Warsaw, and would certainly help him now. So far, life had been good to Leutnant Fuchs. During his Jew hunting days, he had managed to secure a few loose diamonds, some miscellaneous pieces of jewellery, as well as quite a bit of cash. Enough to see him through the next few years. He was hoping to get to South America and start a new life in a country where everything was cheap, including women, his greatest weakness. When he wasn't drinking in sleazy bars around Krakow, Fuchs lay low in his apartment on Placz Tepański, enjoying the good food and alcohol he was able to purchase on the black market. As far as people understood, he was a Polish artillery officer, having a break after the war, and would eventually make his way back home to Warsaw when the city had become habitable. Everyone knew that at least 80% of Warsaw was in ruins, so no one queried his stay in Krakow. Anyway, he was handsome, amiable, and more than paid his way. A generous tipper. And as far as his landlady was concerned, he was a good tenant. When he arrived in the city, Fuchs already had the name of a Catholic priest, a Nazi sympathiser who had helped other German military personnel in their hour of need. Ralph tracked him down quite easily, and Monsignor Dragonovich suggested he might be able to help while he was in Poland. He explained that the church was anxious about the very real prospect of the Russians annexing Poland in the same way that Hitler had annexed Austria. There would be vile masters who would abolish the Catholic Church without hesitation. There were those within the church, some said as high up as the Pope himself, who were keen to feather a few nests by helping Nazis move on to a new life. A favour given results in a favour owed, Dragonovich had said, with a glint in his eye. Fuchs was enjoying a glass of wine while reading a newspaper when he heard the key turn in the lock of his front door. He smiled and stood to greet the woman as she entered the apartment, helping her remove her coat and offering a drink. One of the greatest pleasures he had in Krakow was this woman's body. She was elegantly slender, taller than he was by an inch or two, but he did not see that as a problem because he felt good at her side in restaurants. So many men stared jealously. Some women too, and that excited him greatly. They had met over a month ago and hit it off immediately. 3 weeks later, he gave her a key to his apartment, and she visited twice a week, stayed the night, cooked for him, and pleasured him in a way no other woman ever had. "What a day I have had, Ralph," she sighed wearily. "Here, drink this and tell me about it," he said, passing her a glass of red wine. "Can we talk in bed?" "But it's only 4 o'clock in the afternoon. There's a curfew on lovemaking now." She raised her beautiful arched eyebrows and smiled suggestively. She had turned up a few days after he made his first tentative inquiry with the church about South America. She acted as an intermediary, she said, something she had done for several Nazis already. She made mention of the arrangements she had facilitated for Adolf Eichmann, a senior Nazi and one of the most wanted men on earth, who was now well on his way to Argentina. Fuchs was more than impressed. "I have been with a certain bishop this morning, Ralph, discussing your documents. He is adamant that before the church helps you, you must prove you are in the SS. He raised his right arm, showing his blood type tattooed in his armpit, a sure sign of his stature. Then he walked across the room to the wardrobe and opened it, removed his grey uniform and showed it to her, the SS lightning bolts on the lapels. "What more do you need?" She said she had to provide photographic evidence to the church as they were getting nervous about the number of Germans fleeing to South America. I am arranging for a camera next week. Cameras and film are not easy to come by, so you have to be patient, please. Once I have the equipment, we can take a photograph for your new passport and satisfy the rest of the church's requirements, and away you go. Oh yes, you need to decide which country you want to go to, as they will have to arrange a visa and travel permit. It can all be done, but there's no rush. And she snuggled up to him from behind, deliberately pushed her breasts into his back. But I am already bored and frustrated. How will I pass the time? I am not a tour guide, she whispered in his ear. I was thinking of a better way than tramping the streets, looking at old buildings. 5 minutes later, he was watching her slowly undress, as thoughts of Argentina or Bolivia were pushed to the back of his mind. What are you staring at? She cooed, as she let her dress fall to the floor. I am just admiring the view. She tilted her head, as if puzzled by his reply, but the smile on her lips was evidence enough that she knew exactly what she was doing and what he wanted. How do you manage to get such beautiful underwear? He asked, taking a large gulp from his wine glass. A woman has to have ways and means during these difficult times, she said, unclipping her bra. She knew how to catch a man, how to bait him by playing shy and a little chaste, but always with a hint of what was to come. She had pretended to be reserved and modest when they met, but he had no doubts that beneath the facade was a body that promised delights that most red-blooded men could only dream of. He watched her breasts and gulped quietly when the bra came off, enjoying the way they hung when she placed one foot on a chair and leaned forward to undo her suspenders. She rolled the silk stocking slowly over her knee and down her calf. Her skin was smooth and soft, and he loved nothing better than running his tongue up and down her thighs, which always elicited a moan from her. It was not long before they were both in bed, naked beneath the sheets. His breath was already heavy and laboured as she rolled on top of him, straightening her arms so she could lean back and peer into his face. She liked to see his self-satisfied expression, that arrogant look that most SS had, and she closed her eyes as she gently lowered herself onto him. When he was inside her, she moved very slowly, taking him off to that special place that some men kill to visit. When they first met, he did everything in his power to bed her. She pretended to resist for a few days, talking about morals and her role as a church intermediary. She said that she would be passing messages on now, and it was best that he not visit the church again, a necessity to avoid suspicion. He knew that Polish women had little to offer but themselves after the war, but he was not afraid to splash his cash around. After all, money talks. So he bought her expensive gifts, quality goods that were almost impossible to find in Poland at that time. But he found them, and she loved them. So they ended up in bed together. Now she was riding him, sitting astride, rising up and down slowly as she stared at his face. When she suddenly stopped moving, he opened his eyes. Don't stop. What's wrong? There's nothing wrong, Ralph. I just want to try something new. She slipped off the bed and went to her handbag. He smiled smugly as he watched her tight, pear-shaped bottom sway as she walked across the room. What a woman! She was back almost as quickly as she left, placing something on the bedside table, then showing him the mask she had in her hand. It is one of those blackout things, you know, when you cannot sleep and need to shut the light out. So who wears it, me or you? And what else do you have? What did you put on the bedside table? So many questions, Ralph, she teased, pinching his nose. Now don't be a naughty boy. When you have this mask on, you will not be able to see what I am up to. Now won't that be fun? It'll be like a sexy version of the game Murder in the Dark. She tweaked his right nipple and laughed. Do you want to play or not? Okay, I'm up for it. Just hurry up. If you keep teasing me like this, it will all be over. Then we will have to talk and pretend we like each other. He was like a child at Christmas, unable to sleep because he wanted to see what Santa had left for him. Lift your head, she said. He raised his head off the pillow, and she slipped the mask over his eyes and tied it at the back. Can you see? I like to see, you know that. But can you see now?
No, but I have a great imagination and a terrific memory. His hands found her breasts and cupped them. She sat astride him once more and wiggled a little.
Come on now, he complained. I know this feeling only too well, with or without a mask. Can't you do any better than this?
Oh, yes, she purred, as she reached to the side of the bed and picked up the peacock feather she had placed there a few minutes before.
What's happening? He asked.
She moved the feather over his mouth, down his neck to his chest, before tickling his belly button.
This is much better, he said, squirming.
You want something else, Ralph? Do you want more?
I want everything, he said eagerly, like a spoiled child.
Then you shall have it, SS Leutnant Ralph Fuchs. And she slowly withdrew a metal meat skewer from inside the hollow peacock feather and drove it at an angle through the gap between his ribs, piercing his heart. His eyes opened wide, and he stared at her momentarily, deep in shock, as if to say, "Why did you do that?" Then he bucked slightly. His whole body shook, and he gurgled something she could not understand before taking his last breath. Chapter 3. Hermann Göring was having a fine time at the Palace Hotel. He may have been locked in his room at night, but he could exercise around the gardens during the day, allowing him to walk off the withdrawal symptoms caused by no longer having access to morphine and other heavy drugs. It was hard at first, but he could be determined when needed. The Americans gave him writing materials so he could make notes for them and send letters. He did, in fact, write to his wife, Emmy, addressing the envelope to her parents' home in Switzerland. The letters were opened, censored, and then posted by the authorities. Interrogations had started soon after Göring arrived, and they continued on a daily basis, sometimes informally during his walks in the garden with Gillen, and at other times more formally in an office with an American major and a secretary taking notes. Hermann saw the interrogation sessions as a game, his intellect being at least equal to those questioning him, if not higher in some cases.
So, Herr Göring, Reichsmarschall Göring, if you don't mind, Major, you know that your rank is meaningless now that the war is over. You have lost your titles. Only to you, Major. Ask any German in the street who I am and they will know. Let me ask you about the artworks we found in your motorcade. What do you have to say about them? How did you acquire them?
Göring smiled.
I purchased them legitimately. So you have receipts? Somewhere, I suppose, but I heard that my house was bombed and I dare say they were destroyed in the process.
The artworks were looted, weren't they, Herr Göring? We have details of the museums they were taken from, dates and times as well.
It's quite a haul. The art was taken for the Fuhrer, for his galleries and personal enjoyment, you understand. I only had his cast-offs.
Hermann could not resist the opportunity to lecture someone about the finer things in life.
You know, there's a lot of modern art in my collection, because Hitler despised it. He said the modern style was just a phase, a fashion statement, if you like, and it would fade as quickly as its star rose.
But you have several works by Jews, don't you? What about them?
Like I said, degenerate pieces were not welcomed by our Fuhrer. But I saw value in abstract expressionism, I still do. Picasso will be an excellent investment, Major, if you are interested. Gottlieb also.
We have a division of experts already looking for stolen art, Herr Göring. It would help us enormously and probably help you too, if you were to point us in the direction of missing pieces. There is a great deal as yet unaccounted for. Göring laughed expansively.
I do not think I can help you, Major. You see, after we acquired the art, it all went under the direct control of the Fuhrer. He decided where they should go, not I. I know far less about its final resting place than you suggest.
But I think you do, Herr Göring. I think you know the whereabouts of a great deal of looted treasure and artifacts.
My dear Major, allow me to explain. I am indeed far better informed than you could ever imagine, but in other matters, not stolen art.
Göring stared into the distance with a smirk before muttering,
If you only knew half of what I know.
Later that day, the Göring brothers Hermann and Albert enjoyed afternoon tea together in the garden.
Ah, Albert, I fear that sadly the halcyon days of the Göring family are gone forever. Those wonderful times that used to be filled with wine and roses are just a distant memory now.
I never saw them as glorious, Hermann.
But you never lived as well as I did, dear brother. Did you know that I once kept lion cubs in my house?
Albert shook his head. No, he couldn't remember.
I did indeed. That is, until they got a little too large, so we had to get rid of them. But we always replaced them with smaller ones. It was such fun having the little beasts roaming around the house and grounds. Emmy adored them.
Did you ever work out how much money you spent on Karin Hall? Or should I say wasted? Hermann said that money was never an issue, and he poured himself another cup of tea, although what he really wanted was a decent drink.
My dear brother, if I was to tell you of the riches I enjoyed, you would never believe me. However, let me tell you this.
He scanned the immediate surrounds to ensure he was not overheard.
As much as I spent, if not more, is waiting for me when I get out of here. Actually, between you and me,
he looked around the garden again,
I know the whereabouts of a train that is full to overflowing with gold, precious jewels, and artworks. It is waiting for me in a sealed tunnel, the location of which only I know.
Albert poured himself more tea, and Hermann passed the sugar bowl.
No sugar for me, I am on a diet.
Hermann laughed aloud.
Ah, yes, I too am dieting, but mine is enforced, as indeed is my withdrawal from dependence upon certain substances that are not obtainable here for some obscure reason.
He handed the delicate china milk jug to Albert.
Let me continue about the train. This may interest you.
The familiar smile was no longer on Hermann's face, having been replaced by a serious expression somewhat akin to a frown.
Just before the end of the war, the Fuhrer took me aside and shared some very confidential matters, Albert. I must confess that while I expressed a keen interest in his atomic aspirations, Hitler wanted an atomic bomb. Indeed he did. And between you and me, he was well on the way to achieving it. Except the end of the war intervened. He knew he had to have a plan B, and that was where I came in, because he was involved in a very risky transfer of funds at the time. Gold was to be sent to South America, Spain, Italy, all over the place. Then it was to be banked and sent to those organisations that were providing certain products and services that, when collated and assembled, would produce a weapon that would blow the world apart.
Hermann stopped his narrative and grinned like an excited child. Albert looked on in astonishment as his brother calmly continued.
Now then, how ridiculous was that? Hitler was going to destroy the very countries he wanted to rule, Russia, Great Britain, and America. Nothing that man ever did or dreamed of doing surprises me, Hermann, though much leaves me horrified. Once the attackers, the Nazis became the defenders, and they lost, thank goodness.
Hermann assured Albert that he felt the same. It was a ridiculous plan and a waste of money and resources.
The amount involved is beyond your imaginings, Albert. And just within my own. Now here is the thing that I wish to talk to you about. I redirected the Fuhrer's gold train to a certain location that only myself and that fool Bormann knew. Bormann is dead now, and I alone have the coordinates. If I were to tell you, do you think you could bus me out of here and get me to Switzerland? You would have to bribe a few people, that is true, but they would trust you more than they would ever trust me. You are still a respected businessman. Whereas I am a common criminal. Why would they believe my intentions to be honourable?
Albert sniffed derisively.
Hermann, as always, I think you are pissing in the wind. Now, Albert, I am just floating the idea. You have not heard how much is involved yet. I can give you access to, say, $3 million, US, cash, gold, or a mix of both. You get the bribes lined up, get me out. And together we will collect the loot, and I promise you on my wife and daughter's lives, I will give you another 5 million. That's more than you could earn in 2 lifetimes, dear brother.
Albert smiled amiably and placed his cup and saucer on the table.
Hermann, if I believed you for a moment, I still would not be able to help you. You see, I was advised this afternoon that I will be leaving here tomorrow morning, at sunrise. They are setting me free, Hermann, as I have nothing that interests them other than my name. I was not a member of the Nazi party, and never wanted to be.
Hermann's jaw stiffened and his eyes narrowed.
So your Jew smuggling has paid off.
If you wish to look at it that way, then yes, it has. You would be foolish to think that all the Jews were killed. Some successfully hid in Berlin and other large cities.
Hermann stared blankly at his brother. Me? I tend to look at things differently compared to you. I shall do my best to shake off the Göring curse. I wish you well with your dreams and wild imaginings, Hermann. I am going back into daily life to make my fortune again, and to do it in a way that does not involve corruption or devious activity, or, as in your case, outright theft.
The next day, Albert was taken from Camp Ashkan and returned to Germany. He never did make another fortune, and his role in saving the lives of hundreds of Jews was not acknowledged until much later in his life. Sadly, he died penniless. Joseph Stalin was enjoying himself immensely now that the pressure of the war in Europe was over. He met with Churchill and Roosevelt's successor, Harry S. Truman, several times to decide upon the division of Berlin. Stalin had always been keen to conquer the German capital, and the British and Americans left him to it. The death count was high.
Let Stalin have his glory. We still have to settle the war in the Pacific, Truman said.
During their last meeting, Truman pulled Stalin and his interpreter aside.
Tell me, Joseph, what happened to Hitler? The Red Army captured the Fuhrer bunker beneath the Chancellery building in Berlin, and everyone said he suicided. Hitler? I do not know, but we have Goebbels' remains, I can tell you that. His wife and children? No, we're not interested in them. But Hitler, Josef. Hitler and Eva Braun.
Stalin laughed aloud. He was enjoying this game of cat and mouse very much.
I told you, I don't know where he is. He's probably living under a rock in Argentina by now, he said, with a mischievous grin.
The Russians had eventually found what was purported to be the burned remains of Hitler and Eva Braun after several days of searching and questioning those they captured in and around the Fuhrer bunker. A direct order from Stalin ensured that the remains ended up in Moscow, and Stalin enjoyed reading about the efforts of the Americans and British as they endeavoured to trace Hitler's final movements. The theory was simple enough. There was no body. So there was no proof that Hitler was indeed dead. Stalin knew different. J. Edgar Hoover ran the FBI with an iron fist. He knew what was happening in each division and with every agent. Case files passed through his office on a monthly basis, and there was so much gossip and street talk around the world that he was convinced Hitler could still be alive. He had written personally to the president, who briefed him about Stalin's comments regarding Hitler and South America. It was well known that U-boats had been seen in and around the coast of Argentina, supposedly a neutral country, at least a year before the end of the war. Local agents claimed the Germans were dropping off gold and currencies of all denominations, paving the way for an exit route, no doubt, because by 1944 it was clear who was going to win the war, and it was not Germany. The Office of Strategic Services, OSS, had been formed halfway through the war to gather intelligence about German activities, and agents had been recruited in key countries to send information back to Washington. President Truman decided to formalise the roles of the OSS and change its name to the Central Intelligence Agency, CIA, a department that would act independently from the FBI, who would revert to dealing solely with homeland security. The CIA was then given the task of finding out the truth. Was Hitler alive or dead? If they could prove that he did indeed die in the Berlin bunker, then they would close that particular file. But if by chance he had survived? First, they had to locate Hitler, and then they had to decide what to do with the most evil and hated man known to humanity. It was thought that kidnapping him would be impossible so soon after the war's end. Extradition was also impossible, especially if he was in South America. That left just one alternative. Assassination. First, they had to prove that the Fuhrer was still alive, and locating him would be no easy matter, as there were plenty of Nazi sympathisers around the world willing to shelter him. "If they do find him," Truman said, "they had better make sure they kill the son of a bitch." Agent Joe Walker's wife, Irene, was particularly pleased that her husband had survived the war unscathed. Working for the FBI and hunting down possible subversives in the United States was far safer than being at Normandy on D-Day. However, he had recently been transferred to the CIA and chosen to be part of a secret mission abroad. And Irene was not happy.
"It's what I have to do for my country, honey, you know that. The war is over, and they are sending me to hunt Nazis. It's the opportunity of a lifetime. There is no espionage, no spying, and it's no big deal. Nazi criminals are on the run all over Europe, everywhere apparently, like a plague of rats. We have to establish an office, identify the key individuals, and then track them down. I will be more of a clerk than anything else, I promise. It's as safe as the Empire State Building, and I am hoping that after everything is in place, you can come pay me a visit in Berlin. I hear the view of the damaged city is something to be seen at sunset."
His attempt at humour was ignored.
"People on the run can be desperate, Joe, you know that. And these people are ruthless Nazis. They would not care about killing you or anyone else if they needed to. I mean, look at those concentration camps. Terrible, just terrible. No, I have a real bad feeling about this, and you know only too well how intuitive I am. And anyway, what is Sugar and I supposed to do when you are away?"
Joe looked at his 4-year-old daughter, who was so sweet that her real name of Isabel was quickly replaced with the nickname Sugar after her birth. And Sugar it had been ever since. Joe held his arms out and the child leapt into them.
"How long will you be away, Daddy?"
"I don't know, hon, but I will be back before you know it."
He buried his head in his daughter's thick, brown, shoulder-length hair and felt the warmth emanating from her tiny body as he squeezed her. He refused to let go when she wriggled and squirmed, and a tearful Irene joined in the wholesome family hug.
"Don't go, Joe, please," she whispered earnestly in his ear.
He put Sugar down and hugged Irene once more, kissing her neck before pulling away and giving her a determined look. Joe was his own man. It was a tearful farewell, Joe watching his two favourite girls from the rear window of the cab as he left for Washington National Airport at Gravelly Point. This was his first overseas mission, and he was determined to make it a success. If he did, there was a chance that in a few years there would be a plum desk job waiting for him at the Pentagon, or even the White House. Joe had already been briefed, and while he told his wife that he was chasing Nazis, that was not quite the truth of it. He was after one German in particular, ordered by no less than President Harry S. Truman, who was to receive weekly updates personally from Rear Admiral Sidney Sewers, the newly appointed director of the CIA. The cab dropped Joe at the American Overseas Airways hangar, where he was greeted by his co-agent for the mission, Paul Rivera. Rivera was in his mid-30s, single, multilingual and married to the job, a career agent who loved chasing bad guys and messing around undercover while adopting a variety of aliases using forged documents. He had been successfully spying around Europe throughout the war years for the OSS and was to take the position of senior agent in this mission after being called to Washington to be personally briefed by Sewers. Rivera was not fazed by the task he had been given. He personally thought Hitler was dead, as most people did, so he was looking forward to an easy mission, meeting with various snitches and stooges around the sleazy underworld of Europe and South America. Sure enough, there would be plenty of nervous Nazis hiding under stones, in cellars and behind doors, and he could well run across a few of them in the coming weeks and months, but that, he thought, would be the extent of it. He watched Joe Walker stride across the tarmac towards him, a clean-cut younger man, straight teeth that almost glinted when he smiled, cheap suit, white shirt, black tie, and a college haircut.
This was his first mission, and it showed. Walker looked more like a deer caught in the headlights than a CIA agent. Walker knew of Rivera's reputation. He was considered to be a man who always got the job done, often leaving a mess behind for others to clear up. But he got results, and ultimately that was what mattered to Washington. Hoover loved him, and Rivera knew it. The word modesty did not exist in his vocabulary. When Rivera shook Walker's hand, his first reaction was that Joe was a man who knew his way around a filing cabinet and desk. He would not be much help if things got a little rough, which Rivera hoped they would. He loved intrigue and the rough and tumble that often accompanied it. He had a swagger about him, an arrogance that relayed the message, "been there, done that," to everyone who knew him. He had been around the world a few times, been involved with some nasties along the way, and served his country diligently. Accidents and slip-ups only happened to other agents, according to Rivera. He was far too experienced to fall foul to an amateur in a foreign country. After an initial handshake, Rivera said, "Good to meet you, Joe. Sue has told me you were involved in weeding out..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.